Well, it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah. She broke your throne and she cut your hair, and from your lips she drew the
good morning. So happy to see all of you here today and to be together in this time of worship. I just have a couple of announcements before we get started. And one is a question. Do we have men's breakfast tomorrow? Thank you. It's not in the bulletin, and I had it in my head, and I'm like, I better ask. Tomorrow morning, men's breakfast, 9 o'clock at the little, what used to be the little cafe. It's downtown. Just circle around until you see us and come on in. So. 9 o'clock though. And this afternoon at 5 o'clock, we have caroling here at the church with the refreshments and such with it. So it'll be hot chocolate and cookies and all that kind of yummy stuff. There is no fellowship after church today because of that. So you all have to go to Bob's house and have lunch. And just kidding, Bob. Yeah, Bob just looked at me. But there's other announcements on the back of the bulletin, other activities that are taking place, some Bible study this week in Eubank Hall on the 11th at 9:30. And then next Sunday is our choir cantata. The choir will be presenting an extended music they've worked on, and it's going to really be great. So a lot of activities this time of year. And in my family, we were going through the calendar, and like, what are the things that are going on this week? And it's just full. Every day's got two or three things at least on it that are kind of critical. And rather than complaining about it, I'm like recognizing that it's always this way. It's never not this way. And that's a good thing, because it's time to celebrate and be active. And you guys being here today is a testimony to that. So thank you for coming, particularly our guests and our visitors. I noticed we have quite a few today. We're glad that you're here. And I hope that you find this to be a very inspiring time to be together. Now, are there any other announcements? Yes, Sally.
I just have a celebration that after the end, I moved back into my house on Thursday.
Woo! I can't find a darn thing, but I'm there. Yeah. Now, when did that hurricane hit? I'm trying to remember. 6 years ago, was it? I know it seems like it has been forever. So, Sally, I'm so glad that it all worked out for you, finally. So, Barb, come on up. Barb is going to give us some information and on some of our mission things going on.
And it's on?
Yep.
Okay, great. I'm Barbara Stoles. I am the chair of the mission committee here at First Pres. And every year in December, we like to give a little bit of highlights of those, a few of our ministries that we've served. The rest of the reports you'll be able to find in our January annual report. This year has been no different than the others. It just seems to get busier and busier. So this past year, the peanut butter and jelly team actually had approximately 1,800 different individual interactions with the homeless here in New Smyrna Beach. And besides, and besides serving them, they also let them know that each church, our church, recognizes their existence and their humanity. The bike ministry continues to meet every Wednesday, and this year, between repairing, refurbishing, and renovating the used bikes, they will anticipate of doing over 250 this year.
Wow.
Yep. And Celebrate Recovery is no different. They are ministering to 10 to 15 participants every week. And on their monthly dinners, they are serving 20 to 35. And those dinners are prepared by the members of our fellowship committee. And in 2024, they will be celebrating 15 years of continuous service right here from New Smyrna Beach First Presbyterian Church. And through our Presbytery Disaster Funds, which we went down to, we were able to support a group that went down to Fort Myers to help rebuild from last year's hurricanes. But it also gave us the opportunity to gather information so that we could bring it back to our church and start our own disaster plan right here at First Pres. Colors of Hunger, they celebrated their fifth anniversary this year. And through August, they served close to 16,000 meals. Wow. And again, with never an interruption of service. Thank you. The mission committee this year, we had the opportunity to work with the Presbyterian Women's Hearts of Hope on two of our mission projects. And with the generosity of this congregation, we were able to deliver school supplies to two of our elementary schools here in New Smyrna, along with $600 to each of the schools for future students' needs. And then we worked with them on the Operation Christmas Child. And again, with the congregation, we were able to deliver 173 boxes this year, which was a 43% increase over last year. So wow. Thank you. And then finally, we hosted our first Rally Sunday this past fall, which I guess you could call it a trial run. It showed many of the work and ministries within the church, as well as showing opportunities where you can get involved. And now that the snowbirds are on their way back, we will be doing another one in February, and hopefully that will be our annual event every February. So on behalf of the mission team, the ministries, and the recipients that we all serve, we thank you all for your generosity and your support. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. And as you applaud, you know, recognize you're applauding yourself. None of that would happen if it wasn't for you and your contributions and participation and support and all those things. So thank you. With all that in mind, are any other announcements that I... Oh, yes, yes. Thank you. I want to make sure that I make this announcement before the... I was going to think about doing it for the pastoral care thing, but very sadly, this past week, Martha Neiswanger's mother passed away over in Port Orange, and we're going to have a service for her here at the church on 3 o'clock on Saturday. It'll be right here in the sanctuary, and the family and friends are all welcome to come. And if you never met her, you need to come and learn about a really remarkable woman. She was really, really wonderful. And so that'll be next Saturday, 3 o'clock, right here. Okay? Any other announcements? Yes. Yes. Over the fellowship hall, there are two boxes, and they have members. Every member has a folder in there. And people that want to give Christmas cards this year, you can mail them to people, or you can bring them here to the church and put them in their folder. So two things, bring your cards and put them in the folder, and then go over and check your folder. I went last night and looked at mine. I had three cards in it. They were really cool, so it's kind of neat. At least I think it was my folder. I'm not sure. I might have. That whole reading thing. But anyway, so please take advantage of that. It's a great way to, you know, spread some joy. Anything else? All right. Well, let's turn our thoughts and our hearts over to God, and let's begin our time of worship. Thank you.
In days when God's people long for peace, Isaiah declared, "Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, and that she's received from the Lord's hand double all her sins."
We who gather today also seek comfort and peace. Yet we are unsatisfied with ideas of peace that tell us to keep quiet and go with the flow. We long for real peace, true peace, just peace.
We light these candles as a sign of God's shocking hope and just peace. May they be beacons calling us to repent and to live the good news of Jesus Christ as we wait and watch and labor for the day when all people can gather together to worship and glorify God. Amen.
There's one small. That's you.
Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the light that you have sent and are sending into the world, the light that even now lights our path. Come among us and grant us hearts that we are humble and ready to receive your peace. Reveal to us your glory and comfort all your people. Fill us with your spirit as we wait the one to come in hope. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now gather together as the people of God, let us confess what we believe using the great words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now let's take a moment to greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you. Let's find our seats. Thank you. Thank you.
to the star that gilds the east, golden of heart and burning with peace, seed of the torch is rising yonder, lifting our hearts with glorious wonder. Raise every candle, shine the news, Christ the light is coming soon.
Thank you so much. Christmas, we were just commenting up here during the greeting time that Christmas music just brings it out, doesn't it? It's just so, it's so beautiful. And I hope you will consider coming back this evening for the caroling. It's just, it's wonderful. We turn now to our scripture reading for this morning. I'm going to begin with the reading from John, the first chapter, verses 6 through 8, and then 19 through 28. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Now this was John's testimony when the Jews of Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Christ." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the desert. Make straight the way of the Lord." Now some Pharisees who had been questioning him, "Why do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany on the other side of the Jordan where John was baptizing. And then we turn to the book of 1 Thessalonians, the fifth chapter, and we find these instructions from Paul. "Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not put out the Spirit's fire, do not treat prophecies with contempt. Test everything, hold on to the good, avoid every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's turn to God for a moment of silent prayer. Amen. Okay, it's that time of year, right? It's getting a little bit frantic. You notice the Amazon people going up and down your street all day long, you know, and things have changed. I actually found a mall that was open, and I thought, that's an old experience. Yeah, not many of those around anymore that aren't outlet malls, but it's kind of a crazy time, and I don't know about you, but there just still seems to be so much to do, and Christmas is like right around the corner. In 2 weeks from now, we'll be celebrating Christmas Eve. In an old Peanuts comic strip, Charlie Brown says to Linus, "You know, life is just too much for me. I've been confused from the day I was born. I think the whole trouble is that we're thrown into life too fast. We're not really prepared." And Linus turns to him and says, "What do you want? A chance to warm up first?" Yeah. The season of Advent is supposed to be our chance to warm up. That is, in another 2 weeks, it will be over and the big day will be here. All of the decorations will be in place. The packages will all be wrapped. The last cards will have been received, and then ready or not, Christmas Day will be here. Yay! It's great. Will you be ready? I mean, really ready for Christmas, for the real Christmas, not the Christmas of Santa Claus and reindeers and all that sort of thing, expensive gifts and tinsel. There's nothing wrong with any of those things. But will you be ready for the birth of the Christ child? In our scripture lesson from the Gospel of John, a strange voice comes from the wilderness, "Make straight the way of the Lord." Or as the Living Bible translates it, "Get ready for the coming of the Lord." Are you ready? Are you ready for Christmas? Paul in 1 Thessalonians writes about another Advent. He tells his readers, among other things, to rejoice always, to pray without ceasing, to give thanks in all circumstances, and to abstain from every appearance of evil until the day when Jesus comes again. In a sense, he's telling them to get ready. Get ready for the grandest, greatest Christmas of all. So I ask you, are you ready for Christmas? What are some of the impediments that might hinder us from being ready for Christmas? What are some of the obstacles that Christ might find, or to use John's imagery, on the highway into our hearts this Christmas season? Let's consider four elements as we have drawn from Paul's letter to the Thessalonians. First, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, and abstain from all evil, or the appearance of evil. If we can do those things, perhaps we will be really ready. Let's start with rejoice always. One of the most depressing facts about Christmas for some people is the fact that everybody is not happy. There are persons who have lost the ability to laugh, to play, even to rejoice in the Lord. They may not be misers, but they may have a great deal of load on their hearts in some way. They might have the spirit of Scrooge in them, and there might be a reason for it. Very much the Grinch that can steal Christmas. Something in the life has made them afraid maybe to trust life, to trust other people, to trust God. Dr. Raymond Moody put it in his book, Laugh After Laugh, quote, "It is well to recognize that some people are actually fearful of joy, elation, pleasure, or other usually positive emotional states. And many of these people, being joyful causes them to have feelings of guilt, shame, or unworthiness." Unfortunately, with feelings that these things have crept into the attitude of many, many people, many of them very faithful Christians. When missionaries went to one tribe, a group in Africa, they told the people there that once they became baptized, they could no longer dance. Can you imagine that? No longer dance. They did. That's right. Those Africans who converted to Christianity began to be known as, quote, "the people who gave up dancing." How sad, how sad. We need to be reminded that our Puritan forebearers banned the celebration of Christmas. Did you know that? Yeah, just watch enough TV with me, you get enough history that you know. That's right. They banned it. They were people that thought that it was frivolous and pagan. There are some people today who are really afraid of being happy. They nurture their fears, their resentments, and their hurts. They shut themselves off from others and seek to live as little islands unto themselves. They're not ready for Christmas because they will not let Christ set them free. They need to be like the quiet young writer who came into the wildly uninhibited Zorba, the Greek, and said to him, "Teach me to dance." If there's ever been a time for dancing, it is at Christmas time. The Lord of all the heavens and earth has come to our world as a tiny baby. What a supreme cause for celebration. Rejoice always, Paul writes. Some of us are afraid of giving into that kind of unadulterated joy. And then he writes, pray without ceasing. A second impediment to our preparation for Christmas may be our prayer lives. When Paul says, pray without ceasing, does he mean that our spirit should never be very far from God's spirit? Yes, I believe so. It's not a matter of being in constant dialogue, but it's being constantly in the presence of God. That's a powerful thing. Prayer should be such a natural part of our lives that we're always prepared for his coming, because he's never been far away. Let that roll over you for just a moment. Charles Allen writes about an outstanding businessman named Arthur Rank. Mr. Rank has an elevator straight up to his office, but he never takes it. He walks up the steps every day, and he calls them his prayer walk, his prayer stairs. And when he walks up in the morning, he prays to God to guide him every step that he takes on of the day. And as he takes each step separately and deliberately, he prays. In the morning, he walks up those steps asking God's help. In the evening, he walks down those same steps thanking God for the help that he has been given that day. I dare say that Mr. Rank is probably ready for Christmas. There are so many people who think that Christmas is to be celebrated by working up some mushy, sentimental feelings about God and the Christ child one day out of the year, and then putting those feelings back on the shelf for another year. Those folks are not ready for Christmas. So how is your prayer life? Is it bringing you daily into the presence of God? Karen Phelps, he's a long-distance runner, wrote recently, quote, "On this particular day, I didn't feel like running at all, but I made myself because running is a sport you have to practice every day. I wanted to win races, so I had to set a plan for training. One, run daily, even if you don't like it. Two, run daily, even if you sometimes have to skip fun and pleasure. Three, run daily, even in bad weather, even if people think that you're weird. Four, run daily, even when it gives you aches and pains and you feel like quitting. And last, run daily, even if you don't feel it's doing you any good. Our day," she continued, "as I jogged one day, as I was jogging along on my training run, it came to me that daily practice training was what my spiritual life needed. And you know what I learned? Sometimes you may not feel like praying or reading the Bible or going out of your way to help others, but if you're in training, physical or spiritual, you'll do it." She's ready for Christmas, I dare say. "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and then give thanks in all circumstances." It's so easy to be thankful at Christmas, isn't it? We have so much. Santa Claus will reward us with so many nice things. The stores have been filled this year with symbols of our material affluence. But for some people, material affluence becomes a spiritual poverty. They grasp at things eternal because internally they are paupers and there's nothing there. Give thanks in all circumstances. I mean, could you give thanks this Christmas if some of your things that you cherish most were stripped away from you? How about your sight or your hearing or even your speech? There was a little girl who was born in 1880 in Tuscumbia, Alabama. Her name was Helen Keller. You know her story. She came into a dark world without sight, without hearing, without the ability to speak. She was blind, deaf, and dumb. What a dark world she lived in for this little child. But one of the stories of the century is how she came out of that darkness and into the light of the world in which you and I live, never seeing with physical eyes the light of the sun that we see, never hearing the sounds that we can hear, but she lived a full, rich, abundant life. She graduated from Radcliffe, cum laude, when her teacher, Ann Sullivan, finally brought her to where she could understand and receive ideas and concepts, and she came to know about God and Jesus. Helen Keller said this, "I always knew that there was a God, but I never knew what to call him." She had very few of the blessings that you and I have, but listen to how she describes the meaning of Christmas for her. It's entitled, "A Christmas Legend." A legend tells that when Jesus was born, the sun danced in the sky, the aged trees straightened themselves and put on leaves and sent forth the fragrance of blossoms once more. These are symbols of what takes place in our hearts when the Christ child is born anew each year. Blessed by Christmas sunshine, our natures, perhaps long leafless, bring forth new love and kindness, new mercy and compassion. And as the birth of Jesus was the beginning of Christian life, so the unselfish joy of Christmas will start the spirit that is to rule the whole next year. The unselfish joy of Christmas. Could you give thanks if you were deaf and blind and mute? Helen Keller was ready for the coming of the Lord. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. And finally, avoid any appearance of evil. The greatest threat to our being ready for the coming of the Lord is always the power of sin in our life. There are families who will be painfully splintered this Christmas because one partner in a marriage relationship did not heed Paul's words to avoid even the appearance of evil. There will be lives lost senselessly in the nation's highways because some persons confuse wild revelry with real joy. There will be persons who will feel only coldness and cynicism this Christmas season because they have wandered so far from God that they can hardly find their way back. Avoid any appearance of evil. Christmas is a time of coming home, a time of remembering. Christiana Rossetti's little poem says, "What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring him a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. Yet what can I give him? I'll give him my heart." So are you ready? Are you ready for Christmas? Are you ready for the Lord's coming? Or are there still obstacles on the highway that the Lord must travel into your heart? Let us pray. Our Father, we are all on that journey, all of us on that highway. And this time of year can be a tremendous distraction from that, or it can be the center of everything that we do and say and are. We thank you for the opportunity to be the people that you have called us to be. But give us courage and insight, inspiration, motivation, all those things that draw us closer to you. And fill our hearts with a tremendous sense of rejoicing today and every day. For we rejoice in the coming of the Christ child. Amen. Let us give to God now our tithes and our offerings. Please be seated.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kissed your baby, you kissed the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know?
I have several prayer requests I'd like to lift up to you. Some of them are a little hard to read. Most of them are in pencil. Can you see that? Anyway, this one, I think it came from Susan. It's hard to say. But this is for Carol Bailey, who has stage 3 cirrhosis of the liver. So please keep Carol Bailey in your prayers. That I could read quite well. This one is for my daughter, Shelley Gear, for thyroid surgery on Tuesday. in New York City. Is that right? Audrey? Where's Audrey? Yeah, where's the surgery going to be? Right here, okay. Well, NSB and NYC look a lot alike, so. But we'll certainly keep Shelley in our prayers on Thursday, you say, right? Okay. Tuesday, sorry. I can't read. This one is shocking. Bill and Chris Biedenbach is it the Spork family? Spork family, for the death of Simone, their daughter, and our exchange daughter. She was 29 years old. Bill, this is shocking. I did not know about this. It just got her. Wow. She worshiped with us here. She was just a delightful young woman. I know your heart is heavy because of that. That's very shocking. Are there anyone else that we should be lifting up in prayers? Of course, Martha, the loss of her mom. Yes. Yep. I would echo that. I got a phone call from my son last night. He lives up outside of Nashville. And I said, well, we cleared out our spot and we have our crash helmets on. And he wasn't kidding. He sent me a picture because of the tornadoes going through. And he's not terribly far from Clarksville, far enough that there wasn't any damage to him. But so many people impacted. If you saw the videos, it was horrific, horrific storm. And, of course, it continues to come across the whole country. So I saw that there's going to be really bad weather up north, so, which is why you all are here, I think, is probably one of the reasons. But anyway, anyone else? What? Sorry, Sally, you already did that one about your hand. This is a season of peace. We need to pray for that fervently. All right, let's turn our thoughts to God. God, sometimes we feel that we are overwhelmed with awe because of the wonder and the mystery of your presence in our lives. We don't know when you will appear to us, but you continue to surprise us, touching our lives in unexpected sacred moments of wonder. You come to us at an hour we do not expect. And as we enter this season of Advent preparation, it is easy to get so caught up in the bustle of our day that we miss your presence in our midst. Slow us down. Still our anxious worries of what's left undone. Quiet our hearts to hear the inner rhythms of peace. Awake in us a hope and open us to the miracle of new possibilities for our lives. Help us, O God, to not be so caught up in our own busyness that we are blinded to the needs of those whom this season of joy and expectations might be especially difficult. Enable us to be candles in the dark to people who are lonely, to those who are struggling with disease and illness, to those who grieve a loss, to those who have no place to call home, to those who are worried and anxious about the future, to those who are alienated from the ones they love, to those who are victims of oppression, injustice, and violence. You alone are the source of our hope and our healing. Your presence continually reminds us of our connectedness to one another and to you. And so we wait in patience and expectation and alertness and anticipation. We sense that you are very near, and we await those holy moments when your love and your light fill us with radiance and hope. Make ready our hearts to accept the gift of new life that is struggling to be born all around us. And hear us as we join our voices together in the great prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand. Thank you. Please stand. Before you leave this place, take some time to greet those who've been worshiping with you on your pew and welcome them in the name of Jesus Christ. And come back tonight at what time?
5 o'clock.
It is indoors this year. Last few years we've been out in the parking lot. This time we will not be dodging cars. We will just be sitting in chairs. And there will be something to eat, as there is almost always here at the church. I need to see Beth Vercolin, Shelley Gravel, and Larry Horton at the back of the church, because they got your name tag. You're probably wondering if they're in trouble. They're not. They just need their name tag. Take some time to greet each other, and don't be in too much of a hurry. But I look forward to seeing you all this evening and throughout these coming weeks as we're coming to the birth of Jesus Christ. In just 2 weeks, we'll be celebrating Christmas Eve here. It's a wonderful, wonderful celebration. And I thank you all for being here, particularly those that are visitors. And we hope that you will come back, and we appreciate you being here. So receive now the benediction of our Lord Jesus Christ as he goes before you and follows after you and leads you along the way until at last we are all safely in his home. Amen.